Hello, this is Dr. Phil Rosenkrantz again. We're now in Chapter 4, which is Presentation Number 6, where we're going to be talking about more interest formulas. If you go to Slide Number 2 and look at our big picture, we're still talking about the time value of money concepts. Again, very important for this course. Go to Slide Number 3, and we'll talk about some components of engineering economic analysis. The present value and future value lump sums, single payments, were fundamental, and that's what was covered in Chapter 3. But some problems are more complex than that, and so we're going to introduce some other types of cash flow series. We talk about uniform series, arithmetic gradients, geometric gradients. Nominal and effective interest rates are in Chapter 4, but I've already given you the formula for that in the previous presentation. There is another type of compounding called continuous compounding, but I'm not going to put that in this lecture. It's in your book. It's very simple, and you can refer to it if you need to. Let's go to Slide Number 4. If you'll notice in your textbook, if you'll grab it, hopefully it's still handy, if you'll look on the inside cover, you'll see that we had covered the single payment formulas at the top, but the uniform series formulas are the next four that you see, and you'll see that there's two different cash flow diagrams there, and each one represents two types of formulas. So we're going to rush through those, not in near the detail we did for Chapter 3, but just to make sure we understand what these different factors represent. So the first one we're looking at is called the series capital recovery factor. Now in your book, it's the third one down under the uniform series formulas, and you can see that there's a cash flow diagram there, and it refers to the uniform payments that will be required to recover an initial investment. So in other words, if you have some amount P that you borrowed, what would be the uniform series of payments required to pay that off? And I just made a cash flow diagram for illustration purposes. You can see if the interest rate is 10% per period and the number of periods is 9, then you would have the elements there of a series capital recovery factor. Now, we'll refer to that as the A over P factor because it's a lot easier to remember. So that's our first one. If you go to Slide Number 5, we have the series compound amount factor. Now that refers to an amount that you would have at the end of an investment if you make constant payments, and those payments then compound and grow. And so F equals A times the F over A factor for I percent. Percent and periods. And that would be the one you'd use to figure out how much you would have at the end of a series of payments, equal payments. As an example, if you were to put $500 into an investment every year at 5% a year, then at the end of the fifth year, you would have $2,763. What you'll notice is that the last $500 goes in at the end of the time period at the same time that you're pulling out the $2,753. So that's not a mistake. The timing of the last payment in a uniform series like that coincides with the disbursement. And so to use the factor notation, it's that just simply 500, which is the uniform series value, times the F over A factor, 5% for 5 years. Look that up in the tables, plug it in, and crank out the answer. By the way, that cash flow diagram is made from an Excel spreadsheet. And That's a way that you can make cash flow diagrams using Excel. More on that later, maybe. Let's move to slide number 7. Uniform payment, the series sinking fund factor. And so that's the second one listed in your book under uniform series. And this is the constant amount that you'd have to put away so that you could accumulate a specific future amount. So, for example, if you wanted to have $1 million in 40 years and you were going to have an interest rate of 5% and annual compounding so that n equals 40, you could actually calculate how much you'd have to put away every year so that you'd have that $1 million in 40 years. You ought to do that. It's not as much as you'd think. Let's go to slide number 8. Finally, the series present worth factor. And so this is just the present value of a uniform series. And so if you're wondering what the equivalent amount would be right now to receiving monthly payments of, say, $100 a month for 20 years, you could figure that out using this factor. Okay, moving ahead to an example. This is example 4-6 from your book, and we want to know what the future value is of a series of cash flows, and what we have is a uniform series for 3 years of $100. We want to know what would be the future value of that at the end of 5 years. Now, this is an important example because it illustrates the concept of equivalence. What you'll notice, if you look at the cash flow diagram, you'll notice that the future value that we're wanting to find does not coincide with the final payment of the 3-year uniform series. So what we have to do is we have to find out what the future value is of that uniform series at year 3, and then treat that as a present value relative to year 5, and then find out what it would be worth in 2 more years if it was compounded as a lump sum. And so we have to go through a 2-stage process to get this answer, because we don't have any formulas that will do this exact type of problem. The timing of the cash flows doesn't fit with those cash flow situations we have tables for. So we find out what the future value would be of the 3 years at $100 per year, and if in this case 15% interest, and that's $347.25. Now if we then find what the future value of that is in 2 years with annual compounding, we multiply by the F over P, 15% N equals 2 factor from your book tables, and we get the final answer is $459.24. So notice that we're using the principle of equivalence here, and as long as we're moving the cash flow at 15%, whether we're moving it ahead or back, then we're maintaining equivalence. Let's go to slide number 10 and look at another example. Now we want the present value of 3 cash flows from years 2, 3, and 4, but those don't fit any of our cash flow situations we have tables for, other than noticing that we have 3 lump sums. And so we have 3 single payments. So sometimes you have a situation where the simplest way to solve it is to just find the present value of each cash flow and add those up to get the equivalent present value. So in this case, we have to find the P over F factor for 2, 3, and 4 years in order to solve this. Moving to slide number 11, I'm going to talk now about arithmetic gradients. We have on the inside cover of your book, at the bottom, a section devoted to arithmetic gradients. And we have 2 kinds. The first one, well, what is an arithmetic gradient? What it is, it's an increasing cash flow amount. And the increase is equal every year starting after year one. So at time period zero, you have a cash flow out of zero. At time period one, it's also zero. And then it goes up some constant amount every year after that. And so the gradient in this case on the slide is $10. And that would be a pure gradient. If you look at the cash flow diagram at the bottom of the inside cover of your book, you see a cash flow diagram that shows just that. It shows zero at year one, a cash flow of G at year two, and then it goes up G every year after that. So it's 2G, 3G, etc. And so that's what a pure gradient looks like. If you have a cash flow that looks like a pure gradient, then you can use the factors. Sometimes, however, we have a gradient combined with a uniform series. And what we do in that case is we can decompose the cash flow into a uniform series and a pure gradient. We can calculate the present value of each of those and then add those together to get the present value of that series of cash flows. So we're going to look at example 4.8 just to show you what that looks like. I'm not going to go through it in great detail. You can go through it yourself later on. But in the current text, it's page 113, and the cash flow diagram is at the top of page 114, and you can see that we have a gradient, but it's not a pure gradient. And what we're going to do is decompose it into a uniform series and a pure gradient by subtracting the amount shown for year one, which in this case is $120. So if we subtract $120 from all the cash flows and use that for our uniform series, then what we're left with is a pure gradient. Now we can find the present value of each one of those, and we can add those together. Now for this example, this problem, you wouldn't multiply those factors together, you would just add them together. And that's one way that we can solve some complicated problems very easily. Okay, let's go to slide number 13, and we'll look at our other arithmetic gradient. This time, we're converting from an arithmetic gradient to a uniform series. And that we're going to look at example 4-9 in your book. And here we have a uniform series and a gradient mixed together again. But instead of finding the present value, we're going to find a uniform series that's equivalent to that gradient. And so we can decompose the cash flow series into a uniform series and a pure gradient. But here we're going to use the A over G factor, not the P over G factor, in order to get the uniform series that's equivalent to our gradient. And so you can see how that problem is solved. Okay, let's go to slide number 14. We're going to mention here the geometric series. And if you look in the inside cover of your book and you go to the top of the next page, it shows the geometric gradient, and it shows you some factors, but those factors aren't in your book. Those aren't in your tables. And then it gives you a couple formulas, one of which is a little gnarly, but these are the formulas we use for what we call a geometric gradient. And a geometric gradient is one that isn't going up a constant amount every period. It's going up at a constant rate. So it's going up at a percentage. And so if you're talking about inflation or deflation, then these formulas can be pretty handy. And so you have to plug in the interest rate and the gradient rate of increase. and you plug that into the formula to get the present worth factor for a gradient like that. And so the example in your book is 4-12 and of a geometric gradient. And if you follow through that and notice that there's two formulas, one when I equals G and one when it doesn't, and use the appropriate formula, then you can find the present value of a geometric gradient. And so, anyway, I'm not going to go through in detail on that. The book shows you cranking it out manually what it would look like, and then it shows you what the how the formula works. So anyway, that's the end of Chapter 4. Just to summarize, Chapters 3 and 4 talk about the equivalence formulas that we use so that we have the tools we need to use all the methods that we're going to be using in Chapters 5 through 9. And so you need to master these concepts from Chapters 3 and 4. Thank you for your time. Bye.